screen, and then once you start, then at that time you can start, like a full screen later on.
Okay. Let me try and see how that works. There are some issues here because I can't see it.
Yeah, now it's a screen.
Okay.
And then once you start, then it.
Okay, let me try and share that.
Yes, yes.
How is that now?
No, this is at this moment you are sharing the different screen. There is a one, yeah, this is okay now.
Yeah, that's right.
Now you see the full screen, right?
Yes, yes, now this is okay.
Okay, okay, excellent. So do you want to leave it or should I shut it down until you start?
Okay, I think you can keep it for a while. Or in case if you want, you can just maybe remove for a minute or two, or then I will introduce you and then after that,
sure,
you can share a screen again.
Yeah, you can do it again, yeah.
Yes, this is better.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, because in the past I have trouble sharing a screen through this one, but I get the help of Iman yesterday, so she helped me to fix it.
So Barman Saab, let me know that when we have to start, so because I, at least 5 minutes.
Wait, up to a few minutes.
Yeah, now, 5 minutes before I will start introducing.
8 minutes to go.
Yeah, okay. Dr. Burman, can we start now?
Yeah, you can start. Let people join. So
I will introduce them.
Before that, I welcome all of you. Our today's speaker, Dr. Abdul Baghi Ismail, and he will be introduced by the chairman. And today's session will be chaired by Dr. R.K. Singh. Let me introduce Dr. R.K. Singh. He is currently the head of crop diversification and genetic section at International Center for Biosaline Agriculture, Dubai, UAE. And he leads research teams studying crops such as cunea, barley, mustard, safflower, trees like date plum and halophytes also. He started his career in 1986 as scientist at ICAR, Central Soil Salinity Research Institute at Cornell. Later on, in 2005, he moved to International Rice Research Institute as a rice breeder for salt-affected areas, where he had led the traits development team focused on salinity, heat, and problem soils. Dr. Singh led the teams which developed and released several salt-tolerant rice varieties, including basmati rice in India. You know, he has a lot of contributions for the development of rice variety, especially coastal areas and salt affected in the stress condition. He has published many research journals in internationally recognized journal, many books and other publication also he has made. And he has received many awards from the different organizations. And in this session, the proceedings will be recorded by Mr. Nitish Ranjan Prakash. He's a scientist from Central Soil Salinity Research Institute, Regional Research Station, Canning Town. Now I invite Dr. R.K. Singh to start the proceedings. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Burman. Actually, it's my proud privilege to be chairing this session, the plenum lecture 4. And also to introduce a very distinguished scientist, Dr. Abdul Baghi Ismail. And we had a very close association with him throughout my career on the salinity. And if I say that Dr. Abdul Baghi Ismail, he's the very right person to speak on the way he is talking about on agriculture system transformation for food and economic security in the coastal zones. Let me talk about his credentials. Actually, it's so many things are there, and then I cannot explain everything because he has a big list on his CV particularly, but I will just tell the highlights of that. He's a principal scientist and also regional representative of IRI in Africa. So he is representing the IRI in Africa. And also he has more than 30 years of research and development experience focusing on crop improvement to enhance the adaptation to the unfavorable environments, and that too to increase the resilience to the climate change, which is very, very relevant, particularly for this international symposium. And he worked mostly on the floods, drought, and salinity. And these all three stresses, sometimes they go together in the coastal areas, which is very relevant. Also the nutrient deficiencies and toxicities. He also contributed to advancing the understanding. So he has more than 250 publications in the peer review articles, chapters, books, etc. And in that, they just mentioned about the understanding of mechanism associated with the tolerance to several abiotic stresses in crops, and also to the development and deployment of stress-tolerant variety. He was a coordinator of STRASA also. So he just immensely worked for that. And that really contributed to the farmers, particularly in the sub-Saharan Africa, as well as in the Asia, and particularly South Asia. And when we talk about the proper system, deployment of stress variety, the proper system of crop and resource management packages, because it's only variety will not work, but he also had the grasp on that, and he just developed something which also advocated the cropping management system along with the variety. So that's why they say that crop and natural resource management system. He has a notable impact on the Asia and sub-Saharan Africa and led several regional programs and projects on the breeding and delivery high impact varieties. and technology through the building coordination large networks of the research and development partners. And he served as a several leadership roles, including the Deputy Director General of Research in IRI, International Rice Research Institute, and also the head of the plant breeding PBGB, that's called Plant Breeding Genetics and Biotechnology. And currently he's in Africa as a IRI representative. He did his PhD from the UC Davis, University of California, UC Riverside, University of California at Riverside. And he holds that and authored so many things. And above all, he's having so many awards and then also in the editorial board. And also he's a foreign fellow of the NAS Society, National Academy of Agriculture Sciences, which is very reputed. So with these few lines, I can say that about his with the distinguished career. So I invite Dr. Abdul Baghi Ismail to speak about the agriculture system transformation for food and income security in the coastal zones as plenary lecture. Let's welcome him for the plenary lecture for Dr. Abdul, please.
Thank you so much, RK, for this very nice introduction. It has been really a pleasure to work with you for the last 20 years, I think, or so. And great to see you now chairing this session. I would like also to thank the society, the Indian Society for Coastal Agriculture, for inviting me to share some thoughts on how we really can improve agriculture systems in coastal areas, given that these areas now become very critical and quite important. I have been associated with the International Society for Coastal Agriculture for quite some years right now, and I attended a couple of meetings before. So it's really a great pleasure to come back and address the members of this society again. So without further ado, RK, if you permit, I can share my presentation now.
Yes, please. And we can view it, yes.
Okay.
I will ask other people to mute the mic when they are not speaking. Thank you.
So I hope it's coming through well.
Yes, very well.
Great. Okay, thanks again. Okay, I'm just having a small glitch here. Let me get rid of this. Yes. Okay, so as I said, coastal areas are quite critical, especially in the most recent time right now. And the reason for that is it's a vast area, especially in South and Southeast Asia, and to some extent in Africa. If you look at India alone, has about 10.8 million hectares of arable lands in these areas, very extensively being used right now. And about 3 million hectares in Bangladesh, which is considered to be the most vulnerable and fragile region of the Ganges Delta. Probably most of us know about that. The issues with these areas is they are highly complex, they are highly fragile, they are risk prone, but they are important. They are rich sources of diversity and natural resources. And this is extremely important for our progress now and also in the future to exploit this genetic diversity and also to make sure that we keep it, because now there's over exploitation in these areas. It is suitable for diverse production systems, and basically it is a good environment throughout the year. And as you can see from the photos here, it is actually the granary in most countries for cereals. You see oil crops, sometimes vegetables, pulses, and also fisheries. And it is an area where you really, unique area where you see this conversion of agriculture and aquaculture in one system. I'll focus more on examples from rice, because this is where they have been associated for quite some time, and also the rice-based system. And if you look at the contribution of coastal areas, you can just clearly see it from this slide here. If you look at just the coastal three coastal deltas in Bangladesh, this is the Ganges Delta, contribute 57% of the total rice production of the country. And as you know, in all these countries, rice is the major staple food. In Myanmar, Ayer Wadi contribute about 53% of the total country production. And in Vietnam, the Mekong Delta contribute about 50%, and the Red River Delta contribute about 21% of the total country rice production. As you know, Vietnam in since about 2005 become very important for rice production at the country, at the region, and also globally, when at some point it was the first rice exporter. Now I think it is the third important exporter. So you see how critical these deltas are and how important for us to make sure that they continue producing. But there are issues. There are real issues with the deltas that have to be addressed at the global level. And I'll show you a couple of examples of these constraints. This is our some of the real problems that we are facing right now. We know historically these deltas, these coastal areas are disaster prone. So they are affected by cyclones, typhoons, coastal storms. We have seen this becoming more frequent in recent years because of the climate change issues. One unique characteristic of these coastal areas is they are very dense in population. And that causes exert a natural a pressure on natural resources and also on the environment. And that is why you see both biodiversity is being lost, and also the natural elements, like particularly soils. You see natural forests like mangrove forests and so on, they are overexploited because when people do not have sufficient food, they try to look at whatever there also is overfishing in some of them. So the soils are degraded with high salinity, and good example is in India, when there is more than 2.6 million hectares of saline soils in coastal areas. In Bangladesh, there is close to 1 million hectares. And these are deteriorating. Every year it is increasing for reasons that I'll mention later. There is problems also for wet season farming. Waterlogging is quite common, as you can see in the lower panel here. It's very, very indicative of how waterlogging look like. This normal about 50 to 60 centimeters of water is staying for most of the season. Beside, we normally start with high salinity at the beginning of the wet season, and then flooding later on, and probably a drought spell later on, and then salinity at later stages. It's a very complex process. The dry season always have high salinity because of this. There is no rain, so the evaporation increases accumulation of salt at the surface of the soil, and also the intrusion of salinity from sort of tidal movement from the sea, especially with sea level rise right now. And freshwater resources are always scarce. The climate change is causing trouble. It's really making all these issues more adverse right now, especially with sea level rise. This is very, very clear right now in South and Southeast Asia. There is more and more salt intrusion, as you see the stories from South Bangladesh and also from Vietnam, where they usually lose quite a few thousands of hectares every year to salinity, which are not affected before. And also the abiotic stresses become more severe, especially salinity, drought incidents, floods, mainly the rain become more erratic, unpredictable, and more intense when it comes in. And also there is emergence of new pests and diseases with different dynamics and different pressures to do this climate change. So there is quite a few issues that are facing these deltas. And I want to mention two main problems which are rising now, because as we get more and more advanced in technologies of how to assess these deltas, it becomes clear that it is actually the situation is more grave than we think before. In this slide, I want to show that the elevation of these deltas is actually much lower than what we think. If you look at this, this is just an example from the Mekong Delta. The average elevation of the delta is assumed to be about 2.6 meters. This is based on global elevation data. But the reality is not that. When new models came in right now and using ground measured metadata using novel, what they call novel elevation models, it's actually only 0.8 meters. So you can see that the elevation is very low and the sea is going up. 0.8 meters is actually is quite low. And you can see that now with intrusion of saline water inwards a few kilometers every year. So the message from this is really these deltas are much more vulnerable than we think. And also this probably apply to all deltas because all the old measurements are based on these global models, which is really under overestimating the height of, or the elevation of these deltas. So it is a real problem, and it's something that we have to worry about. The other example I want to show is these coastal deltas are sinking and are sinking fast. If you look at this this model showing cumulative subsidence since 1991, the red color means it is getting deeper and deeper. So you see that it is already showing an average of about 18 centimeters below the sea level, 18 centimeters sinking of these deltas since 1991. But if you look at more recent data in 2015, you show that the rate of annual sinking is actually much faster, between 1.1 to 2.5 centimeters. And in some areas, you see more than 4 centimeters per year. This is much more than the increase in sea level. So you have sinking of the deltas and increase in sea level. So this is really showing that there is real disaster that is waiting for these deltas, and serious measures have to be taken to avoid these problems. Most of these issues are man-made, like especially in South Bangladesh, the Ganges Delta, and also in Vietnam, the Mekong Delta. Most of this is because of overpumping of groundwater. Although there is some contribution also from exploitation of natural resources like gas in South Bangladesh and so on, but pumping of fresh water, especially for big cities and also for irrigation like shallow tube wells and so on, is the major cause of sinking of these deltas or coastal areas. And you can see the impact even on building. This is in Ho Chi Minh City. You can see some buildings are really near to collapse right now from this sinking. So there is issues that we have to be aware of and to have to look for ways how to address it. But despite this issue, this delta, this coastal zones hold huge potential for current and also future food and nutrition security at the global level. The good thing is addressing issues of those also is quite important for us, especially for the United Nations targets. Especially for food security and poverty alleviation and nutrition security and so on. These areas are highly populated with the poorest people in the world. So addressing these issues probably will be able to solve SDG 2 immediately, Sustainable Development Goal 2. And also poverty is very high. So addressing issues of poverty will be able to address the targets of SDG 1, which is quite important. So these areas, as I said, they are most affected by climate change, and most of the issues also are human induced, like this over-exploitation of natural resources and water pumping and so on, which is really causing real deterioration in these deltas. The potential comes from that the production systems in these coastal areas are still dominated by traditional systems. So still most farmers are using traditional varieties, and also the production systems are relatively traditional. And sometimes you see one or two crops only when there is potential for up to three crops per year. So there is huge potential really to increase the productivity and income of farmers in these areas. These areas definitely miss the benefit of a green revolution for obvious reason that green revolutions focused on irrigated areas. And most of the varieties that were developed at that time and is still being developed for favorable areas lack the tolerance of abiotic stresses that are common in these areas, especially salinity, stagnant flooding, and drought toxicities, and so on. So it is clearly evident that if we really be able to address these issues that are facing coastal zones, this will help us also to prepare ourselves for future climate change adversities. If we were able to develop a resilient production system that have resilient varieties, resilient management system, and so on, to exploit this potential. So again, these areas are quite rich in resources, especially water and land resources, but need to be properly managed. The weather conditions are always favorable throughout the year because of the amelioration of the climate caused by sea being adjacent to the sea, and also opportunities for agriculture transformation using modern interventions and technologies is quite high. And I'll show some examples of that. Actually, in the past, that is not possible. But right now, I think we have very good understanding through science that most of the problems in coastal areas are resolvable. So addressing this again will help meet the future and nutrition needs of these areas and also the countries as well as the region, and also contribute to global food security. As I said, most of these countries are actually the largest exporters of rice for the world. 90% of the rice in the international trade comes from countries in South and Southeast Asia. And also at the same time improve the income and reduce poverty in these areas, because as I said, the most impoverished communities actually in these countries reside in these areas. It's also a good opportunity for entrepreneurships and businesses, especially for women and youth. And for youth, this is becoming a major problem now in Asia and also in Africa, because they do not want to get engaged in agriculture as it is right now. It's not too attractive, and at the same time, the land holding is becoming too small to support them. So really increasing productivity and sustaining productivity in these systems could help bring those youths and help women who really are handling most of the agricultural practices in these areas. In this graph, I just want to show you why these areas really missed the Green Revolution. If you look at the bottom corner of the graph, this is really most of these coastal areas that are still there. Still using land races, still using traditional practices. When mega varieties start to appear, they started using them, but they risk loss in one every 3 years if a disaster happened due to drought or flood or intrusion of salinity. More recently, stress-tolerant varieties start to appear and farmers now started using them, but really the outreach is still very, very low. And now we start learning that these stress-tolerant varieties respond better to good agricultural practices, to good agronomy and good management. This information now is coming up quite strongly, and I'm glad to say that our teams that working within South and Southeast Asia did a lot in developing these good agricultural practices that are designed specific for varieties, specific for regions, and specific for stress. And it showed that these stress tolerant varieties really respond differently to this management, because you need to increase the response of these varieties or strengthen it. But at the same time, you need to mitigate stress with this management. And now we are seeing that having these stress-tolerant varieties, good management can allow us to go for intensive and diverse production system that can really improve food production, nutrition outcomes, and also increase farmers' income. And I think if we reach this area where we'll be able to develop these options and strategies and make sure that we reach the farmers with them, can easily transfer these unfavorable coastal zones into favorable zones. I'll show some examples of that. So to do that, we need to transition from old varieties to modern varieties. We need to increase the turnover of old varieties. And I think once a variety reaches 5 years, we really have to think about replacing it. This is not happening in this area. Some varieties are just land races, others are more than 30 years old. Also, we need to transition from blanket to stress and variety specific recommendations. As they said, these varieties are responding differently, and practices that mitigate stress are different from practices that we need to adopt under normal condition or favorable condition. We need also to modernize the production system across and also access to input and output markets. In most of these areas, we actually pump the farmers with new ideas and new varieties, but they can't find where to get the seeds. They can't get them in time. They don't know where to put to buy fertilizers. And when they have surplus of production, they are not getting the price that they are getting. So we really have to work on the whole value chain to make sure that the farmers get what they deserve based on what they are produced, so that you can encourage them to work harder and produce more. this is a typical example here in Africa. You go to many places and ask farmers, we have this new technology or new varieties. They said, well, where can we sell it? Because they are really overexploited by middlemen, and they get very little at the farm gate price. So there's also options for more income and nutrition by increasing intensity and diversity. I'll show some example of that's happening right now. And for sure, we need strong enabling policies from government to ensure equality and also faster deployment to be able to make an impact. And I'm very happy to see that happening right now in South Asia more than anywhere else, and also in Southeast Asia. There is very strong support to farmers where policies have been changed, especially during the last 15 years when we are working through stress and so on. I'll show some examples of that later on. So I will start with some examples on varietal development, and then some examples from management option that our teams have been working on, and how that bringing this together really could make an impact. So these are some of the stresses that I mentioned already. Salinity, you can see that very obvious how salinity is affecting crop production. Floods, there's different types of flooding that are problematic during germination. Because direct seeding now become quite important, as you can see in the top panel right one. Complete submergence is very common, but we have a solution for that right now, and also stagnant flooding, which is the most common one in these coastal areas where water is stand for about 50 to 60 centimeters for most of the season. And then intermittent drought, there is also problem with nutrition. There is nutrient deficiencies, especially phosphorus and zinc in saline soils, and it's changing pH, and also nutrient toxicity, especially with iron toxicity in acid surface soils, which is quite common in coastal areas. Now we start seeing also spells of cold and hot temperatures in these areas, probably associated with climate change. So I'll just show you one example of one of its stresses complete submergence. You probably know the story of SOB1, which really now is taking over quite well. The land races that have this trait of tolerating more than 2 weeks of complete flooding were discovered in the 1950s in Odisha, but they didn't come to Irrigation Bank until the 70s. And after screening, they were able to identify few land races like FR13A, FR13B, and so on. And then from that, a mapping exercise helped to identify one major locus, we call it SOB1 now, and that major gene was cloned. And cloning it helped also develop precise markers that can be used for marker-assisted back crossing. As you can see here, this photo is actually in the 70s between performance of FR13A and another variety after flooding. So it is very, very kind of clear impact. So having precise markers for SOB1A also helped transfer this gene very quickly. So by 2006, we already have few varieties developed using this, because now you can do the whole process in about 2 years, 2.5 years maximum. There is so many varieties now have SOB1. As you can see here, these empty areas actually are the original varieties, and the green one are the same varieties with SOB1. So you can see the difference just between like day and night. So this is flooded between 10 days to sometimes to 21 days. And you see the same impact, mainly based on the condition of the flood water. So there is a big impact of these varieties now being disseminated in South and Southeast Asia and also in Africa. Unfortunately, not to wider extent in coastal areas, because coastal areas have multiple stresses and submergence alone sometimes is not very helpful. But in places where there is only submergence, which is flooding or flash flood for not more than 2 to maximum 3 weeks, you can anticipate a yield advantage of 2 to 3 tons per hectare. And also the good thing about SOB1 is there is no penalty on yield or quality if there is no flooding. So it's silent when there is no flooding. So it's a typical example of solving a major problem in both coastal areas and also in inland areas that are facing these problems. There's many varieties that are available now. I'm just showing a few of them. Suvarna Sabhavan now is very famous in India, replacing Suvarna in flood-prone areas, but it is good for areas that are not affected by, affected only by flash flood, not stagnant flood because it's short. But there is new varieties like CR1009, Sabhavan, BR11, and new ones that are coming right now, which are much more favorable for coastal areas because they are taller and at the same time they have Sabhavan. You can see this impact here, like one variety, Keharang Sabhavan versus local varieties. So it's really zero versus very good yield, maybe up to 4 tons or more. Also, there is new varieties coming now for stagnant flood condition. And I'm glad to see that also there is varieties that are combining both, because as I said, for coastal areas, we really need varieties that combine both moderate elongation when there is a stagnant flooding, but at the same time, Sabhavan when there is a flash flood. So this is really good protection. There is also some varieties that are combining salt tolerance with flooding tolerance. RK have done quite a substantial amount of work on that, developing also system for screening and so on. Salinity, again, there is varieties that are available right now. These are just some of the early varieties that were released, CR Dam 405 in India and BD Dam 47 in Bangladesh. But you can see clearly the difference between complete crop loss to recent to decent yield. This is when salinity happened early in the season, and also even if salinity happened late in the season, if there is a drought spell, you can see again a difference. A good crop establishment in both cases of a tolerant variety and a sensitive variety, but the sensitive variety collapsed completely with increase in water or soil salinity or both, whereas tolerant variety can have a decent yield. So this is all excellent for this ecosystem. Even for drought, I'm showing just an example again of one of the early releases, Sabagi Dan in India, and also released in other countries. Again, you can see the difference, very clear impact of having a tolerant variety versus sensitive variety after 10 days of drought. The good thing here, this is again an example of cold tolerance. There is varieties developed, especially here in Africa, and also some of them released for developed for South Bangladesh and also for Assam area in India. Again, there's varieties now available for iron toxicity. And this is, as I said, it, especially in South Vietnam, this is iron toxicity is very important for, because of acid surface soils and also in Indonesia. So the main message is that varieties now are there. This provide good solution. And also not only that, but beyond this, there is varieties that combine multiples of these stresses. And that is exactly what we need for these areas. So, and we are learning a lot from these stress-tolerant varieties. First of all, it's actually providing a kind of assurance of security for farmers to invest more because they know they can get something out of their farming. In the past, they just planted and come to harvest, might be lost, they might have some yield. But now they know that these varieties are protected, so they are using more inputs. They are also shifting from cheap ways of farming to more expensive farming because they know they will be a return for their investment. So they are even investing in machinery and taking good care of their crop and inputs. And also there is an increase in access to credit. Actually, we did some studies on that and we found that the creditors now have more trust in farmers and they are encouraging farmers to take more credit. In the past, it's very difficult for farmers to get credit in these areas. And also there is farmers are getting better yield even in years when there is no stress, mainly because they take good care of the crop. And farmers are now ready to diversify their crops and income sources. So you see improvement in income in many of these areas where these varieties moved in, but it is still limited. And the good thing is through Strasa and other projects where we worked through these varieties, we found that the outcome of these varieties is tremendous change in policies because the governments and the national program realized the value of these. So they were able to amend most of the policies that make these varieties develop faster, release faster, and reach farmer faster. So this is really a huge change in these areas. In some cases, like in India, a variety can be released within a year. Not only that, also at the regional level, if a variety released in one country, the other country can release it immediately. This is through an agreement that facilitated by ERIE and the Indian and Bangladesh government. Now we have about 7 countries ratifying that agreement. We call it Seed Without Border, which allow any country that release any of these varieties, allow other countries to release it. It also harmonized the exchange, the guidelines for release, and also allowed exchange of data and so on. So it is really huge impact at much higher level than just at the farmer level. So the enabling policies and guidelines, as I said, just this example, some examples, we were able now to see that varieties are released much faster, and commercialization of new varieties come to happening very quickly than before. And there is much higher rate of replacement of older and obsolete varieties. Certification system start changing, and this is extremely important for private sector and other seed producers, mainly as a protection mechanism for them to make sure that the seeds come to the market are good quality. And that actually is really encouraging private sectors now to come into play. There is good support from governments to private sector engagement. You can see that in India when we start Strasa, there is really a handful of private sectors working on seed and seed system of these stress varieties. I think by the end of Strasa, we have more than 400 private companies working, producing seeds of these stress tolerant varieties and selling them. And also we are able to work both on formal an informal seed system, because the informal seed systems are still important part, but we are hoping that gradually this system will disappear and then farmers will depend mainly on formal seed system when they can buy fresh and new seeds every year, because that is another contribution of 10 to 20% increase in yield and quality. As I said, regional policies also have changed a lot. So to bring more synergy to these varieties, we have to really combine the genetic tolerance with best management practices. And that showed very clearly in all the work that we have been doing over years. These tolerant varieties respond better to improved management than the traditional varieties. And also these proper practices are more effective in less favorable environments because it addresses the stress as well as improve the response of these varieties. And I would like also to share with you this very old slide. And you can see like the first column here is the farmer variety with farmer management. This is what the farmer used to get and still used to get in most areas. But as they change their management to improve management packages and also change the variety, they get incremental yield. But when they combine them, they get synergy. So they get very high yield. And I'll show you some examples of these. This is one for salt affected areas. And as you can see here, actually, this is the recommended management for favorable areas in that area. It is not the traditional system. But even the recommended system, you can amend it by using improved variety and best management practices, which is designed mainly for these stress areas, salt affected areas, you get an increment of more than half a ton from that. As you can see, from 3.7 to 5 tons jump in yield just by changing management and combining it with variety. I'm showing here some of the management packages, and this is a percent increase due to variety plus best management and variety plus the recommended management and also the modified management, which is mainly tuned towards this specific stress and specific area. The same thing you can see for stagnant flood prone areas. In the past, we used to think that you can't do much there in stagnant flood areas because of the water staying there for sometimes the whole of the season. But there are some ideas that came out from the studies of our team, like Saranja and his team in West Bengal, and also our teams in Bangladesh and so on. So you can really modify the management system, combine it with variety, and you can almost double productivity in these areas. The same thing for drought areas. Again, you can see the incremental increase going from farmer practices to improved practices and improved varieties. So it is very clear that there's synergy when you combine these together. Developing these varieties and good management right now also offer opportunities for intensification and diversification. And this is very important for increasing farmers' income and also for providing sufficient nutrition. Short to medium duration varieties can help add new crops. And also farmers start sowing early or residual crops. For sure, multiple crops are increasing the profit for farmers, and also they're providing assurance for the farmers against disasters. If they lose the rice season, there is still more to come later on. And one of the crops that came out quite well in these coastal areas is sunflowers. We have tried watermelon, tried okra. They have a very good remuneration at the beginning, but later on the market become a problem when larger set of farmers started using that. Introduction of a small handheld machinery also help, because the farmers will have very small spell between seasons, so they can quickly switch, prepare their land and switch the second season. And also because of they can overcome the bottlenecks of and high expense of labor for production, harvest and post-harvest. So hopefully all these processes are mechanized. I think they will also increase not only the production, but also the quality of the produce. And we should think about value addition for crops produced in this area, especially oil crops, pulses, and so on, even rice, packaging, branding. Everything should be done local so that the farmers get the best benefit of this production system. Now, we have all these good ideas, all of them showing a good promise, but they are not reaching farmers. We have to make sure that we take these innovations to farmers, and that is for sure the only way for us to transform this rice-based system in coastal zones. So we need to exploit the synergies of germplasm production practices, diversity, and market reach at the system level. I think I make this very clear from the examples that I have shown. The market is very critical, because increasing productivity without being able to sell the produce is a big loss for farmers and setback. We have to ensure the ownership by aligning with local priorities, strategies, and development and funding schemes. And this is extremely important to align our efforts together with all efforts of the local governments, central governments, regional level, to make sure that we make a difference, because these are big issues. Can't be really addressed by one organization or the other. We have to really make sure that the technologies are developed for a specific target and delivered for that specific target, because these stress prone areas, blanket thoughts will not work. It has to be really site-specific, stress-specific, problem-specific, and even social norms-specific, based on what the farmers really need and where they can access market and so on. And we have to engage all the players to make sure from the beginning there is a good awareness through the administrations and sharing of ideas, and even from brainstorming of what need to be developed for that specific area. Very important to include local people there. It's from our experience, it's become very critical for these remote areas to make sure that there is local vendors for supply of input, quality seeds, and also service provision. If you introduce mechanization and then there is no service there, it is a problem for the communities. So all of these, we have to make sure that they are provided locally, and also should promote local entrepreneurships and businesses, and to help diversify sources of these inputs and services so that they will be a kind of a competitive market to keep the price affordable for farmers. Strengthening public-private sector partnership is becoming extremely clear right now. The role of private sector is unavoidable, and something that we have to work on it. And actually areas where we see real transformation is where the private sector kick off. Government and national programs efforts are excellent in producing products, but to deliver these products in mass to farmers and support farmers, I think it needs these partnerships and also market linkages. I can't really stress more the importance of making sure that there is market for what we promote to farmers and also help them to access these markets. So for future strategies for food and nutrition, income security in these coastal areas, just some ideas. Definitely there is more. we need to make sure that our breeding programs are modernized using latest tools to fast track variety replacement, especially these new ideas that are being used right now. Erie is very heavy into that, and I'm glad to see that also in many countries, especially in India, especially genome assisted selection, use of rapid generation advancement to multiply the number of generations per year, where we can get 3 to 4 generations per year. So we can develop a fixed line within 2 years that can move to farmers. It's usually take about 6 to 8 years before. And genome editing is coming very strongly right now to replace even marker-assisted back crossing and so on. Hopefully this will be deregulated very soon within the region, because it's very clear that it cannot be classified as a genetically modified material. It's safe at the same time. So we have to also make sure that the system we develop are sustainable and resilient to transform agriculture in these regions, because we are not developing systems that can work today but not tomorrow is a real issue. And we can see that happening now with what is the deterioration, the fast deterioration happening now in these areas. We have to make sure that this system really can also increase productivity, but also the income of the farmers. Especially we have to mechanize these operations. We have to work on harvest and post-harvest to keep the quality and also market access. One important aspect right now in agriculture everywhere, digital transformation become very important for efficient operations using artificial intelligence, using drones for different operations, and also delivering information, because now with smartphones and even normal phones, you can deliver information instantly to farmers so they can be able to answer their questions instantly whenever there is any issue that arises. To them, even choice of varieties. There's so many of these apps now are developing for good management for farmers, where they can find their varieties, even managing their irrigation system like AWD and so on. So we have to really invest into this and make sure that the farmers are equipped with this kind of modern digital tools that can help them to access information. Support and enabling policies, supportive and enabling policies, I can say more of that, because without policies and without support from officials in localities, nothing really could be done. Especially if we really want to work together to halt this deterioration happening there, whether human induced or due to climate change. We need this not only local level, but also at the global level. And also there should be global efforts to modernize, to mobilize knowledge, expertise and resources. Problems facing coastal areas are really integrated problems, and mostly at the regional level, and mostly involving more than one country, from river catchment all the way to the sea. So these efforts are to be integrated. We have to work together with international organizations at the regional level to develop holistic measures and holistic high level impact interventions that can really solve these problems. And I just want to share with you one initiative right now that the CG centers are working on. They call it 2 degree initiative. It basically come out from problems that are happening. If you look at land underwater at high tide by 2050, the old prediction showed that this is again the Mekong Delta. You can see that this is I don't know how you see it, but it looked to me deep blue color areas are not that much, but the new prediction show that it's huge. Almost the whole Delta will be covered. So we need to do something to do that, to halt climate change, sea level rise, but at the same time, subsiding of these coastal areas. And this initiative is really great. It's being taken by the CGIAR, focusing mainly on 3 deltas, the Ganges deltas, Ganges Delta, Ayer Wadi Delta in Myanmar, and the Mekong Delta in Vietnam. This is just an initial global effort to really see how can we halt this deterioration and probably hopefully stop it before it happens. It will be a big undertake, and I really encourage the society also to try to engage with the CG centers in these global efforts. this is just one effort, but hopefully we'll see more and more big initiative like this coming together from the collective efforts of the countries who are facing these problems, as well as the donor organizations, the development agencies, people who are working for a goodwill for climate change, addressing climate change and adversities and so on. So if you look at the goal of these are really quite noble, to develop and scale sustainable 21st century agricultural system. So this is big by itself, to make sure that the systems are up to date and the system are productive and also are resilient under the 21st century challenges. Build better climate information system. This is very important, especially what is now known as climate risk maps. These maps are being developed based on models, but they are very informative for policymakers and also researchers and managers to predict what is happening tomorrow and to try to plan early before a disaster happens. I think this is extremely important for these fragile coastal areas, and also improve natural resource management through this information that becomes available. How can we do the best out of these resources, and also enable evidence-based decision-making. So this tool, or develop tools also for decision makers to be able to make the right decisions at the right time. So hopefully we'll see this kind of large initiative coming in the pipeline, but it's really, let's see, start with this one. And hopefully through this collective efforts, as I said, it is not a matter of a single country or a single region to be able to really deal with these integrated problems. So I think this is my last slide. I thank you so much. And I thank the society again for this opportunity, especially for Dr. Sen and all the organizing committee. And also I'd like to acknowledge the contribution of my colleagues, Sahanshu Singh, Amish Singh, Olisander, Manu Ranjan Model, and Sukanta Saranji, who, and together with other colleagues in the region, did really wonderful work that I presented some of it in this presentation. But my hope is that this intervention now will see the way to reach farmers and make a difference in these coastal areas. Thank you so much. Back to you, RK.
Thank you. Thank you, Abdul, for giving a complete wave, like a complete spectrum on the agricultural system transformation for food and income security, especially in the coastal area. The time is constrained, but that's why I don't want to summarize again, because it will be taking like a little bit more time. But definitely you talk about the coastal zone with a huge potential and how we can just use those, like, you know, encash those potential in the food security, particularly addressing the SDG 1 and SDG 2. And this is because of the human induced, and we have to just look for that, and we have to make the potential system, like, which are still conventional, can we go back to the some improved system, and we can tap the coastal zone for food security through the resilient varieties as well as the associated pest management practices, because once we are having the synergies, then only it can work. And also you talk about the green revolution too, which is needed, particularly with the improved varieties. And also like harmonizing the seed exchange, which is a very, very like exemplary system in India and then Bangladesh and those areas. And also diversification, intensification. And the ultimate thing was technology has to reach to the farmer. That's ultimate goal. And definitely on the modern breeding tools, sustainable resilient system and digital transformation. I'm doing quickly because, you know, I can see the signals. Actually, the time is up and then other sessions are going on. So I have like a, please write your questions on the Q&A session, in case if we can take like a one question. Can we take Dr. Burman? Can we take one question? Okay.
Can I have the questions? Abhishek,
I can see. Abdul, can you see the question on the Q&A? That one is that, does saline alkaline soil prevail in coastal zones, or only saline neutral soils prevail? Because this is from Mr. Dr. Abhishek Mazumdar, and we know that mostly it's the coastal saline soils. And current salt-tolerant rice genotypes having good yield in the coastal zone show comparable yield performance under alkaline soil also. And this is also happened that, yes, but you can just answer that, please.
Yeah, thank you, RK. You answered it already. Actually, in coastal areas, salinity is more prevalent. Very few areas where you see the pH is also high. well, salinity and alkalinity combined. So that's why we focus more on addressing salinity. The salt tolerant varieties are just normal varieties, and RK has done most of the work on that. There are high yield, good quality. There's some of them even basmati varieties that are salt tolerant. So the good thing about these genes that come for salt stress tolerant do not have effect on yield. Not like some genes that have been used before for biotic stresses, for example. All the cases of genes for salinity, for submergence, for even anaerobic germination, they have no effect on yield and quality. That's why if there is no stress, the varieties perform normal, expressing their attainable yield wherever you grow them. If there is stress, they are always much better than varieties lacking tolerance.
And the second question, the same like a following question by the Dr. Abhishek Majumdar. In coastal zones, saline submergence is a predominant problem. How best the salt tolerant, submergent tolerant varieties can perform under complete submergence with saline water, which can arise due to seawater intrusion? I think you can also answer this.
Yeah, as I said, RK actually the first one who mastered this work at Erie, where he started developing a system where you can have salt tolerant varieties that is flooded with saline water and still survive. And I'm glad to say that I think at least two of them were released. The first one was released in South Bangladesh. So it is possible again to combine salinity and salt tolerance, even flooding with saline water, which is really fortunate thing for farmers in these areas.
Thank you. Thank you, Abdul. If there is any other question, yes, yeah, Dr. Sen, please.
Can I make a very brief question, please?
Sure.
Dr. Abdul, thank you very much. I joined 5 minutes late. In fact, I don't know whether you covered that part. But I saw that part missing. To me, it appears to be very important. You have covered a wide spectrum, in fact. You have not left any point untouched. But one thing, whether it's a question of subsidence of deltas, the question of temporal and spatial variability in the salinity in other parameters in the coastal areas, one thing is common. We have to get to the root of the problem. One thing that possibly you have not touched, if I have read it correctly, that deteriorating hydrological behavior of the coastal, in the rivers and canals in the coastal ecosystem. That is very, very important, at least what you can see in the entire Indo-Gangetic alluvium. That is one issue. I'm not talking about the climate change alone. There are various issues interfering with that deteriorating hydrological behavior, which possibly will result in the change in the subsidence of the deltas. Already two islands in the coast in the Sundaman area have disappeared completely. It's all because of that. There is not much of flow across the Farakka River, Farakka Barrage. That is here. But in other places also the same thing, I'm told, I cannot name it, but the same thing may be happening. This is a very important phenomenon. If you tackle this issue, possibly you'll get to the root of the problem. It could be retreat of the glaciers, it could be human interference, it could be wrong government policies, and it could be play of these power plants. There could be many, many factors for causing the deterioration of the hydrological behavior across the Indo-Gangetic alluvium, right from Uttarakhand in India to Farakka, 2,000 kilometer stretch. That is affecting both India and Bangladesh.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Abdul.
Thank you, Dr. Sen. This is really an issue. I briefly discussed this by showing examples of subsidence of deltas and also the problem of changing hydrology. I touched it very briefly. But this is a major issue, and this is a kind of a problem that cannot be addressed at one region or at one country, but it needs collective efforts to do that. It is becoming very serious, especially in Southeast Asia. It's even more serious than in South Asia. In Ayer Wadi and also in Mekong Delta and Red River Delta in Vietnam. So these are issues that require collective efforts. Some of it have to be related to sea level rise, and some of it is human induced. This sinking of land in coastal areas due to over-mining either of natural resources, either water or gas or whatever it is, and compaction of the these areas, sometimes even mining, overuse or overtake of sand from coastal areas for construction and so on. So these collectively are causing this hydrologic problems. There is also shifts in tidal movement in some areas. And I think also because of this subsidence, you see the tidal waves now reach much, much deeper in inland and causing these salinity problems. So I agree with you. This is a problem beyond just the research institutions in these areas to address it. It has to be addressed at a much larger level. And it is really a warning for us because the data I show on Mekong Delta, for example, just as an example, these deltas might be lost. These deltas might sink completely.
Yeah, thank you, Abdul. There is one more question, and I can't see the name, HP plus minus 3. So who is this? Please raise your question, unmute the mic, and then raise your question, please. Hello? Yes, please go ahead with the question. I think it's not audible. I know that you unmuted, but it's not. Dr. Sen, you can
use.
Yes, please go ahead. Sorry, I think we are unable.
It's not audible.
You can put it in the chat.
You can put it in the chat in case if you want. Otherwise, it's not audible. Q&A. You can put in the Q&A otherwise. Can you send the by email in case if you want? You can send the email to Dr. Burman and we can address the question. I think with this, there is no other question. So we can thank Dr. Abdul Ismail for a thought-provoking and very nice talk. Actually, this talk was to be, particularly, it's very good for the coastal region. And then not only one issue, but he mentioned about a different issue and also touch up to the livelihood of the poor people here there. So that's why he said that the technology which we are doing, it's not only the technology, but it has to reach to the farmer. And that's the ultimate goal. So with this, I will just thank again Dr. Abdul Bagh Ismail, with whom I had a very, very long association. And in the last, I would like to thank the organizers, Dr. Burman, Dr. Sen, and also our reporter Nitish for conducting the whole session smoothly, or you can say seamlessly. So that one, and then now I'm handing over the mic to Dr. Burman for the last announcement, anything.
I request Dr. Sen, the president, for his remarks from his side.
For the plenum lectures, it is my privilege and prerogative to propose the vote of thanks at the end. So I know Dr. Ismail for my name, of course, and through work for a very long time. Maybe I have met him possibly twice or thrice only in the past. I remember last time I met him at CRRI in 1990s sometime. Then CRRI. And I have got high regards for him. And that's why I was bent upon inviting him as an expert in the coastal ecosystem. There are not many of them who can possibly deliver the goods for the coastal ecosystem in general. And I thank you very much, Dr. Ismail. And next time we meet on 19th at 10:45, and Dr. Rakesh Singh, as well as the reporter, Dr. Prakash also, and all those assembled here, and for a very absorbing lecture for the wide spectrum of the coastal ecosystem. It cannot be covered in half an hour, I know. So, but people have been very glued to the online submission that you made so far. It was very absorbing. In fact, I was in another session as a standing chairman, in fact. So I had to rush from there. I was late by 5 minutes. So kindly, my condition is very precarious. So kindly, thank you very much. One request I have to make, I have to add one line here. So kindly, make a kind of note of possibly 2 pages or so on the sharp point that you want to drive home, which will include in the final proceedings. And possibly Dr. Rakesh Singh can also look at it and then finally forward to us. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Singh.
By tomorrow, please. By tomorrow, please.
Sure. Thank you all. Before closing the session, this session, I would like to make an announcement that we have another plenum lecture today at 6:30 Indian Standard Time that will be delivered by Professor Ratan Lal on a very important topic, impact of soil carbon dynamics of the environment and management of the improved soil health in the coastal ecosystem. So all are requested to join in the plenum lecture. We have also concurrent session started. So thank you very much, all of you, for attending this program, particularly Dr. Ismail, our chairman, Dr. Rajesh Singh, and Nitish. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Great pleasure to see you all.
Thank you very much. It's our pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, RK.
Bye-bye. Okay, have a good day.
Then.
Bye.
Thank you.